What's good, y'all? It's your boy Sean P, the Blump Guy. Hey! And we are back with another One Piece reaction. So today I was, or not today, but I was highly recommended to watch this theory or to follow this theory. And this theory today is from Dax. He's going to tell us about Pluton. You know? Pluton supposedly is a mole of some sort, you know. I don't really know, but you know, that's kind of the video. The title of this video is "The Pluton Sleeping Under Wano Is One Piece Theory 1054." Now, before we get into that, make sure you guys hit that like button. Also, subscribe, hit that bell for notifications. Make sure you follow me on Twitch so you can catch me live in real time and you can engage with me in real time. Make sure you also leave a comment down below. Let me know your thoughts on the theory video, right? The theory, anything that I've said myself, whatever. You know, what do you think Pluton is? You know, if you don't agree with the theory that we're watching or any of the other speculations, let me know your speculations down in the comments. Also, follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook, and make sure you become part of my community. Join the Discord. That is going to be the best place to engage with me at. That's where I'm usually the most active at. And if you want to send me content to react to, the Discord is the best place. I have a submission channel for my members to send me content, send me One Piece content or whatever. Anything outside of One Piece might be used for like a chill stream or something. But yes, make sure if you want to send me content to react to, make sure you're part of the Discord. Anyway, if you guys watch, if you guys follow me, right? If you guys been following me for a while, at least a few weeks, like even if you only been following me for a few weeks, you guys would know that I've done a reaction, like recently, I've done a reaction video to Dawn of the World. I think that was her name. Dawn of the World. She's a relatively, she's a much smaller One Piece theorist than not, you know, than a lot of the other YouTubers that I've reacted to. So, but she had a great theory about Pluton, right? And her theory about Pluton, I think, is not that. I mean, exact. We haven't really watched this theory yet, so I guess we could compare notes after we're done this theory. But her theory is more along the line as like Pluton is not necessarily what Pluton is, but it's a lot of it is about like Pluton, I guess, being built at Enies Lobby, or not Enies Lobby, Water 7, right? And then that big hole in his lobby and that waterfall that we seen in his lobby, that's pretty much how Pluton got from Water 7 slash in his lobby to Wano, right? Because her theory is that it's that Pluton is something similar to the effect of something that burrows under the earth as well, right? So again, I don't know what Daxaki's theory is exactly, but yeah, her theory is something along the line as it being something that digs similar to a mole, right? We know that moles dig through the ground, and her theory is like it's something that does that as well. And I liked her theory. I really liked her theory because, you know, we look at Pluton being a ship. Right, a ship that can destroy islands. That was kind of what it was hyped up to be, a ship that could destroy islands. But what makes if it's something that could go under like Earth, right, and possibly destroy the plates and like destroy an island from under, right? that's, you know, that would make sense how it could destroy islands, not just the traditional way you expect, like a bombardment on an island with maybe some big, huge cannons, or maybe like a big, huge laser, like weaponized laser cannon that could destroy a whole island. No, maybe it could destroy an island from the earth, from under, right? So, yeah, that's kind of my theory based on what I've seen from her speculation, right? From what I got from her theory, that's kind of something I came up with, right? And, or, I mean, a conclusion I came to, right? So, and we talk about it being a ship. It may not be a ship in the traditional sense. It may be a ship in a, where it's an actual vessel or a vehicle, but instead of traveling on the ocean, maybe it travels through the ground, right? So that's kind of what I got. And I kind of want to see how this theory compares with her theory. Because maybe there's a lot of things that cross, right? Maybe there's a lot of connections with both of their theories. So it would be nice at the end of this theory, maybe kind of compare it to Dawn of the Worlds theory. You know what I'm saying? See how they connect. But man, let's get into this theory though, man. Let's get into this theory without any further ado. It's a two-part video. Like I did notice that it was a part two to it. So we're going to watch both parts here. Let's get into the video. I'm excited about this video. Parvision been hyping this up as well as Deck. So we about to get into it. There is a part two we're going to react to right after this one. So,
possible to travel underneath the sea in the One Piece world? And no, I don't mean like heading down to Fishman Island. I mean literally underneath the sea, in the ground, and potentially even riding the currents of magma to get places even quicker. I know that seems crazy, but that seems like a fitting ability for a ship that's given the name of the god of the underworld. And what if I said we already know that traveling underneath the sea is possible? And that's all because of this guy. And you probably have no clue who he is, or that he's the canonical character that is named the legendary boss of the earth.
I didn't know that.
In fact, would you believe that Gidatsu? Yes.
Hold on. I forgot that character. I'm not even going to lie. I forgot that Mo character. I'm trying to remember where I seen him from. Because he did kind of spark a bit of a memory for me. But I was like, it ain't coming to me. It ain't coming to me. So I definitely forgot who that character was.
This Gidatsu. Use this thing to dig under the sea all the way to Alabasta, where tourists now use that tunnel to travel through. You're probably just as surprised as I was.
So he was a on the cover story?
Travel through. You're probably just as surprised as I was to learn that this thing even exists, because it was never shown in the anime, and we only met him during Gidatsu's Blue Sea Life cover story series, and I don't think I can blame you if you skip that one. And I also can't blame you for dropping a like and subscribing to the channel, so I know you want me to keep making content just like this.
Y'all go subscribe. Link will be in the description. The link to this video I will be putting in the description box.
But let's get on to the theory.
Yeah.
Isn't it a little odd that such a huge ability was just casually thrown in there like that? This mole creature transported Gidatsu and his friend to Alabasta by digging underground and avoiding the sea entirely. Which, if you think about it, that is a way better way than a typical ship, because you don't have to worry about weather or other people on the sea. I mean, if I could build any ship that I wanted, then it would be able to dig so that I can travel anywhere without a problem. But the best ship that we know of is Pluton, and as we learned in Chapter 1053, it's hidden in Wano somewhere, and since we haven't seen it, many people seem to think that it has to be hidden underground. And if this is the case, then what if Pluton has a similar ability to the so-called boss of the Earth? I mean, Gadatsu took this thing to Alabasta of all places, which is exactly where we first heard of Pluton. However, we know Pluton is in Wano now, so is it possible that the ancient kingdom dug Pluton from Alabasta to Wano? And we all know Wano is famous for its borders, so perhaps those acted as a way to keep Pluton safe. Alright, maybe I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but we do also have this page, where the legendary boss of the forest is defeated by the legendary boss of the sky, right before they take off underground to Alabasta with the legendary boss of the earth. And what two characters are currently on a collision course in Wano? Luffy, the sun god.
My question for Deck, right, and you might answer this in the video, so you don't have to answer this. You could just say it's rhetorical at the moment. You know. I guess, are you saying that Pluton is actual living Mo, or is like a ship, but it digs like a Mo, you know? But you don't answer that, because I'm gonna finish the theory, you know. I just wanted to throw that out there, because it's just kind of been racking my brain to say Pluton is a Mo. I'm thinking, is he like a sentient Mo, or is he it's just like a machine or something, but you know, we're just going with the term of a mole, you know.
And Green Bull, the forest man, boss of the sky, sun god, boss of the forest, forest man. Maybe you see where I'm going with that. If Green Bull gets past the samurai in Yamato, which really doesn't seem impossible, perhaps the crew will need a quick way to escape. We also know that Vivi is currently missing, and Cobra was assassinated, so if the Straw Hats hear that news, and then ultimately need to get out because of Green Bull, this seems like a very possible destination. I could even see a similar situation at the end of Marineford, where Luffy escaped on Law's submarine. We saw Kizaru and Aokiji use their
That's my man's Kizaru, bro. It's my man's Kizaru.
Powers on the water to try and catch them, and if Pluton can dig, then Green Bull might shoot his plants down into the ground and catch them at the last second. But of course, he would ultimately fail. This would also be kind of funny, because that's twice now where they only escape because of having extremely abnormal ships at their disposal. Something else we know about Pluton is that it has the ability to destroy entire islands. And if you look at the last 5 or 6 chapters, I think Oda showed us an obvious way to destroy islands. Volcanic eruptions. Yeah. Once Law and Luffy sent Big Mom and Kaido into the ground,
I thought you was going to talk about that LaLugia incident. Like, I thought you was going to talk about that as far as destroying islands. But yeah, I've said on the whole other theory I've reacted to, I said I believe that Pluton could have some geology type abilities, like causing volcanoes, you know what I'm saying, or causing plates to move, and you know, just some type of geological manipulation, you know, some type of earth bending or something, I guess you could say. Maybe not necessarily earth bending, but you know what I mean. Because like one of my beliefs, right, when we talk about the ancient weapons, my biggest belief is their purposes or their purpose is to pretty much unite the world by destroying the red line and bringing the world to some level of balance, right? And I said that I believe that Pluton is probably, like, the purpose of Pluton might be to destroy the red line. And this is something I've been saying for a while, but, you know, like, sometimes my stuff, how I feel and what I believe change. But I feel as though, like, I believe that Pluton is to destroy the red line, right? And then Poseidon's a weird one, right? Poseidon's a weird one. I believe Poseidon's purpose could be to help Fishman Island, or let's say, or after you destroy the red line, right? That causes, I would assume that the rocks that go into the water, especially since the red line is so big, and if you're going to destroy the whole red line and not just that area above Fishman Island, but if you're going to destroy the whole red line, or even if you just destroy a big chunk of the red line, I believe the water level will increase, right? So that might cause a lot of flooding, which Poseidon's duty, purpose, might be to carry the Noah, right? Save people by carrying the Noah. And then I think Uranus, if it is potentially a weather control device, weather control device, why do I think Uranus is a weather control device? Because Uranus, as we know, is in Greek mythology, Uranus is looked at as the sky, I guess, like the sky or the heavens, you know what I'm saying? So I think Uranus has something to do with the sky, and it having something to do with the sky, I believe that it might also have something to do with controlling weather. Now, based on one of the recent chapters that we got with you know, the whole Lelugia Island incident, you know, which a lot of people speculate that being Uranus that did that destroyed Lelugia Island, it makes me think, like, maybe I was wrong about Poseidon. You know what I'm saying? Maybe I was wrong about Poseidon. So it kind of made me think maybe I'm wrong about some of the things I said about the ancient weapons. But I don't know. You know, we don't know what that thing was just yet. It could have been something that Vegapunk created. We don't know. You know, it could have been something to do with Eem, right? Like, Eem could have some devil fruit where, you know, he could do stuff like that. I don't know.
Those two holes caused an absolutely massive eruption. So imagine if Pluton dug a ton of these holes all over an island. The entire island would probably explode, thus explaining how a ship is able to cause that much destruction. And now you might be thinking, not everywhere is going to have a magma pool just sitting there waiting to explode, but that is actually where you're wrong. An oft-forgotten offhand comment from Nami proves this, and it again connects us right back to Alabasta. In the very beginning of the arc, we come across a bunch of steam on the sea from what is called a hotspot that is created from underwater volcanoes. Nami also says that there are more volcanoes under the sea than there are on land. She also says that in some thousands or ten thousands of years from now, the volcano will give birth to a new island. And then right after this, we actually get an interesting comment from Usopp that Luffy won't be around to see that happen if he is a human, which is ironic since Luffy has the fruit of the sun god. And I actually talk a lot more.
Oh, so yeah, that would make sense though too, because like I know from how our Earth is constructed, and if One Piece Earth is anything like our Earth, which I kind of assume it is, we have a thing called the Earth Mantle, right? There's different levels to how the Earth is constructed, right? We got the core, which is in the middle. Then we have, I forget some of the other layers, but we got the mantle as well. And I think the mantle is like, y'all correct me if I'm wrong, the mantle is like right under the Earth's crust, right? And that's where I think, I'm trying to remember, because this is stuff I learned from school. So it's like, so the Earth's mantle has like a lot of magma in it. Right, you know, it has like a lot of magma. So if that's how the mantle is like all around the Earth. So I would assume the One Piece world would have like a mantle as well that's filled with magma, like pools of magma all around the world. So yeah, I would think that there are potential volcanoes everywhere in the ocean.
More about the importance of this in my last video, and I'll go ahead and put a link down below. But isn't that very interesting that volcanoes are what create new islands? I mean, this conversation proves that there has to be quite a bit of volcanic activity going on in most of the world, even if they can't see it. That probably means that you could create your own islands if you knew how to make those volcanoes erupt, right? And since we just learned that digging some big holes can cause an eruption to occur, this leads to an interesting idea. What if Pluton not only allowed the destruction of islands, but also the creation? The ancient kingdom could have not only used it.
I noticed where you was going. I was about to like stop it, like once you brought up the idea of like new islands being created. I was about to say, oh, so what you're telling me is, like, I was literally going to say this. I was going to say, so what you're telling me is, not only is Pluton the destroyer of islands, it can also be the creator of islands. But I was like, I'm gonna let him talk before I say that. I ain't want to try to take the shine, you know.
to destroy islands by triggering volcanic eruptions, but it could even create new ones where they wanted them to exist, perhaps to house people near the ancient kingdom as it grew. And this leads me to another big conclusion. If Pluton can handle the extreme conditions of being underground and near volcanic eruptions, it can probably just outright get in the lava. So instead of floating on seawater, it is able to travel through magma, which apparently even runs under the seafloor, as we just learned in this chapter. You have to admit, it'd be pretty fitting for the best ship to not only float on water, but also float on magma. But obviously, this all seems like just a little bit of a stretch. First off, how can...
I guess my question would be, if it's traveling on magma and not water, per se, right? When it's on... Well, I guess that could be solved easy. But I guess I was thinking if it was like on top of the ocean, right? Like, let's say it managed to surface in like a in the middle of the ocean, right? I guess how would it go back under, right? Because it couldn't go through the water because it's not much of a water traveler, travels through the magma. But I guess it would just have to go to like an island, you know? It would have to dig through like actual land. So I guess that's how it would travel back underground, is to go somewhere where it's land and then go underground, you know? Because it is a mole, right? It's a mole, so it would just dig under the ground. So yeah, that was kind of a dumb question, but like, that question just popped in my mind at the moment when you said it travels like through the magma, you know? So, but that'd be one way it travels. It'll travel through the ground and magma, you know, or it can travel in the magma, but its normal way of traveling is probably through the ground. I would assume that's where you're getting at.
Can Pluton even dig? And then how can it also handle magma? I mean, on one hand, it could just be some type of ship with a mole devil fruit, and we actually already saw one of these yet again in the Alabasta Arc. She was able to dig pretty much at will, so maybe Pluton was given her fruit, except it is the model boss of the Earth. Or it could just be this thing's original ancestor that ate some type of ship devil fruit, or my personal favorite idea, it was modified just like Laboon was.
The
and
ship,
we also
ship
know
fruit.
Of Zunisha, who seems to be a freakishly massive 800-year-old elephant, so I really don't think a long-living creature is out of the realm of possibility for Pluton. I mean, the boss of the Earth that we meet in this cover story was actually slightly modified so that it could house Gadatsu and his friend. So could you imagine this, but just on a much bigger scale? And whether it's a fruit or the creature itself, it would help explain how a ship built 800 years ago would be so much better than what someone like Vegapunk or Frankie could build today. That always seemed like a bit of a plot hole to me. But if you don't like the Pluton as a mole idea, a more down-to-earth idea is that it could simply be a ship with a drill on it, and maybe the drill is built from some special material. That could be sea stone, liquor iron ore, or an interesting possibility is that it's from an old awakened user of Waffles fruit. After all,
I was about to say it could be waffle metal, but I was like, how would it be waffle metal when it like predates waffle, right? Like, but again, devil fruit's been around for, you know, like waffles, devil fruit. He's probably not the first person to have that devil fruit. So yeah, it would make sense if it was somebody who had his devil fruit during the ancient weapons, or if we go with the idea that devil fruits are pretty much created through the death of people in the ancient kingdom who were able to manifest abilities. Like, remember that theory? If we're taking that, maybe the person who manifested the devil fruit that Waffle has, maybe they, you know, before devil fruits came about, maybe they're the ones who created Pluton. You know, just throwing that idea out there.
His Waffle metal is already strong enough for the Frankie Shogun, so if you gave that fruit to someone more competent, that metal could probably be even stronger and handle magma. And perhaps you're still thinking, alright, Pluton is a ship. moles and drills aren't ships. And you would have a point there. But as long as Pluton can carry people island to island in some way, it probably counts as a ship. Plus, it can probably float. And if it's a mole, it can probably even stand up and fight on its own, which would just be super cool. But let's compare this to other ancient weapons, because this is where I think it gets even more convincing. The one that we know the most about is Poseidon, who we know as Shirahoshi. She has the ability to control the Sea Kings, and will probably use them to...
I mean, like, look, I wanted to look up the definition of a ship, right? Because I think I still believe just because it's a big drill or even a mole, it could still be considered a ship. So I wanted to look the meaning of a ship. It says, it's a noun, a vessel larger than a boat for transporting people or goods by sea. That's the definition that I got. So based on that definition, like if it's a big drill, right? It could be bigger than a boat, at least, right? You know, it could transport people, right? If it's a drill or some drill-like device. The one thing is it's gonna be semantics, right? It's like transporting people by sea, goods by sea. It kind of does traverse the ocean a bit. I'm kind of splitting hairs here. Like I'm trying to make it work though. I'm trying to make it work, but it's tough. It kind of does travel to sea, just not in the more traditional sense, right? Just not in the traditional sense. Kind of like in Dex's explanation that it could come through it could travel through the magma streams, right? And then arrive on top of like the ocean surface. It would be technically traveling the sea in that situation, right? I know. I'm reaching right now. I'm reaching.
To ultimately pull the fishmen up to the surface using the Noah. In Greek mythology, Poseidon has a pretty direct correlation to the sea, and I think that's important for the other two as well.
Yep.
Because Uranus has direct ties to the sky, and Pluton has direct ties to the underworld. And this is where I believe Oda's use of the word ship has been throwing us for a loop, because it has kind of boxed in our thinking on what Pluton could possibly be. Oda can justify the word ship in a million different ways, but he can only justify the god of the underworld in a handful of ways. Because I mean, think about it. Why would Poseidon control the sea, Uranus control the sky, just for Pluton to float on the sea despite being the god of the underworld? Poseidon would technically be closer to the underworld in this case, which doesn't make any kind of sense. I think it's way easier to justify a mole or a drill or really anything that can dig also counting as a ship than it would be for the god of the underworld to just simply float on top.
Yeah, I guess like I've always tried to justify it, right? Like when we talk about Pluton being in the ship in the more traditional sense, how it was kind of hyped in the beginning when it was meant to be actual ship that floated on oceans and on top of water, right? When I compared it with Pluton, aka Hades, the god of the underworld, I always looked at it maybe because it was destructive, and the fact that it was so destructive, it probably killed a lot of people. And In when we look at killing people, it usually sends people to the underworld. So that's how I kind of justified it. Like when we look at like how we used to view Pluton, like before, like this idea of actually traveling under through the earth, right? But I do believe that the idea of it being able to travel underworld, right? It being able to travel through the earth, I do feel as though that makes more sense. You know what I mean? I do believe that makes more sense than it being more on sea level, right? On the like traveling land to land on top of the sea. You know, so I think it would make sense if it was more of a travel under the world type situation, and on the when we look at the spectrum of Uranus being the god of the sky and then Poseidon being the god of the ocean and then Pluto or Hades being the god of the underworld, which is the underworld, like under the ocean, I guess it would make sense that it would be under the ocean and not over the ocean.
Top of the sea, given all the ancient weapon names. I think we could even see a scenario where Pluton digs directly underneath its final destination and then just shoots upwards through the seafloor and to the surface, thus fulfilling the role of both a god of the underworld as well as a ship. And this could also allow us to make an even more surprising attack on the world government than Whitebeard made on Marineford when he coded his ship and came up from under the sea. So in summary, Pluton is either a mole or some ship made with a special metal that can ride in magma. If you want to hear more unique theories like this one, please subscribe and check out some of my other videos that you should probably already see on the screen. Later.
All right, let's get to the second video, part two. Now I'm assuming this is where the meat of the theory is right here. This is where I'm assuming the meat of the theory is.
Is this for real?
Those are the.
I'm gonna try not to stop it too much. All right, stop it too much. But let's get into it.
Blueprints for
Mole.
Oh, shut up!
Molly.
This video is going to act as somewhat of a part two to my original Pluton video, because there is so much new evidence that proves my theory even further. But this video will stand on its own pretty well, so I would just check this one out after this to get even a little more context. But if you did see the first one, you'd probably remember how I thought Pluton could be a mole or maybe a mole-like ship. And since that video has dropped, the mole gang has grown substantially.
Mole gang?
Even somehow managed to cross 1,000 subscribers in the process, and hey, with the recent chapters
out
and
deck,
some of the new
man.
Information.
Shout out to Deck, man. You moving up, man. You getting it. You getting it, man. Shout out to you. Great theory. You know, you make great theories. That's what happens, man. That's what happens.
Given to me by my mole confidants, I think we have all but sealed the deal on what Pluton really is. And before we go any further, I ask that you please seal the deal on subscribing to my channel. I never thought we'd even get to 1,000 subs, so I'm just gonna up the new goal all the way to 5,000. So
hey man, go subscribe to Deck, man. Go subscribe to Deck Saki right now.
So it doesn't get crushed right away just like the last one. But almost 96% of you who watch my videos anyway have yet to subscribe. If only 6% of you who watch but haven't subscribed yet decided to finally just click that button down below, then we'd hit 5,000 subs overnight. So you know what to do. But onto the theory.
Yeah.
In my first video on Pluton, I talk about how it can almost assuredly dig underground, and I'm gonna quickly speed run the major points of that one just to give some highlights for the context of this video, but I won't cover every point, so make sure to check it out after this video is over. But the first piece of evidence that tells us it may be able to dig is that Pluton is known as the god of the underworld, so it almost assuredly has something to do with underground activities. And there is a little known mole called the Boss of the Earth, or the Dirt Boss for short, that dug Gedatsu under the sea from a random water spring island all the way to Alabasta, where the tunnel is now used by Taurus. And perhaps the way Pluton destroys islands is by digging holes that cause volcanic activity, just like we saw at the end of Wano.
Krakatoa!
And we know new islands.
I was going to say, what if Pluton actually does look like a ship, though, right? Like, what if it actually does look like a ship with a mole devil fruit, and that's why they call it a ship, right? Because it looks like a ship, but it can, maybe it has the ability to float on oceans, but it can also dig, you know what I mean? Just throwing that out there.
Are made from underwater volcanoes thanks to Nami, so maybe Pluton can even create islands using the same mechanism. So basically, I theorize that Pluton is a mole, or at least partially a mole, such as a mole-ship hybrid like Laboon, or maybe even a devil fruit is involved, like a mythical version of Miss Merry Christmas's fruit. And since that video dropped, so many people have hopped on the Mole Gang bandwagon. And now we even have Parvision allied with us, and tons of people from his Discord have helped strengthen the mole agenda even further. So
I just thought about it. Like, it's wild. Like, Tom had the blueprints to Pluton, and he also was the one who created the sea train, right? He was also the person. It just makes me think, what if the sea train was, like, inspired by Pluton in a weird way? You know what I mean? Like, what if the sea train was inspired by Pluton? What if Pluton was like a train looking thing? Or, you know, if it is a drill, right? A drill, you know, some trains do look a bit like drills as well, right? I don't know. It just popped in my mind when I seen that clip of the sea train. I was like, what if the sea train was inspired, or even the design of the sea train is similar to Pluton, you know? Because if you look at the sea train, it's not like a conventional train, right? Like, have you ever seen a train that could travel on the sea? Just like seeing a ship that could travel through Earth. You know what I mean? Like, and that's why I'm kind of putting, that's kind of why I want to make that correlation. Because just like Pluton being a ship that could travel through the Earth, and the sea train being a train that travels on the ocean, it's just two unconventional inventions, or two unconventional vehicles, that's the word I'm looking for, vehicles that were both associated with the Water 7 arc. You know what I'm saying? The same arc we talked about Pluton, you know, because Frankie had the blueprints of Pluton that Tom gave him those blueprints. And Tom was also the one to create the sea train. I don't know. I think there could be some relation there, is all I'm saying.
I'll be shouting out some of these people throughout the video, and make sure to go check out Parvision's Discord as well. So anyway, I released my first Pluton video after Chapter 1054, and back then, I, like many, made the assumption that Pluton was buried under Wano. But in 1055, we had that confirmed. And Sukiyaki also mentioned that Pluton was sleeping beneath their location, or at rest in the official, both of which at least slightly imply that Pluton is alive. While sleeping pushes that agenda even more, I think it's fair to say.
I mean, I'm just saying, those are some particular words to say that it's sleeping or even resting. Like, even in the official, like, resting is something that something alive would do, right? Something living would do would be resting or sleeping. I mean, okay, I see where we're going with it.
Say that at the bare minimum, both words at least hint that Pluton could be a living thing. That's and to true. Add on to this, we had That's an interesting true. Comment from Frankie in Chapter 1056. When it was revealed that Pluton is in Wano, he said, "I can't believe that thing actually exists." So maybe I'm reading too much into this, but thing makes it seem like some kind of abomination. And Frankie knows what Pluton looks like better than anyone, and if we also add the recent context that it could be alive, I think that this could also be another hint. I mean, a modified mole, or maybe a ship with a mythical mole fruit, would probably qualify as an abomination. And shout out to Parvision for reminding me of when Frankie and Iceberg first saw the blueprints, because Tom called Pluton the nastiest monster in the history of shipmaking, and Frankie asked if humans can even build it. If it was simply a mechanical ship like we have seen in the story, or maybe even in real life, I personally doubt that they would talk about it this way. And perhaps the best piece of evidence was sent to me on Discord by Q, and it was about the port deep beneath Wano called Mogura Port. And for those who don't know, Mogura in Japanese means mole. This port was mentioned earlier in the arc as a means for easy entry into Wano. The port existed as a way to go under the walls and have your ship pulled up to the surface of Wano by using some kind of pulley system so that entry was easier and safer. And we saw this with Apu, and that's how he got back in the country. And that means that this port essentially exists in old Wano so that you can pull things up to new Wano. And it is situated directly above where Pluton is today. And it's called the Mole Port. Love to speak. Get that music, please. I mean, you really could.
Okay. What was I going to say? There was something I wanted to say. Man, I lost that clip of Stephen A. Smith made me lose my train of thought. But It made me like, okay. I'm thinking, because we talk about cursed swords, right? What if Pluton was a cursed ship, right? Like it was a sentient ship to a degree, or a ship with a will to it, you know? So in a way, it would be living a bit, I guess you could say. It would be kind of alive.
Didn't script it any better. And since the mole port is all the way down in old Wano, and every other port that we have heard of was in new Wano, I think that this one is worth digging deeper into. Because now that we have the context of old Wano being submerged and new Wano existing high up above the walls, I think it's obvious why and even when the mole port was established. If we look at chapter 1055, Sukiyaki explains to us how the walls in Wano work. And I think it's safe to say that the walls were put up sometime near the Void Century, and presumably they exist to keep Pluton anchored or caged, which we'll discuss in more detail later. But once the walls were erected, then the people of Wano started building the settlement up above, that is, the new Wano we know today. They had to build that settlement because otherwise they would get flooded out, so that means...
Hold on, I wanna rewind that. I wanna rewind what you were saying. Because one thing about those walls, right? Like, and this is, you know, I know I keep talking about the other theory about Pluton. And that's why I want to go back. I'm watch what you say first, and then I'm going to say what I said. I'm going to say what I want to say.
Keep Pluton anchored or caged, which we'll discuss in more detail later, were put up sometime near the Void Century, and presumably they exist to keep Pluton anchored or caged, which we'll discuss in more detail later. But once the walls were erected, then the people of Wano started building the settlement up above, that is, the new Wano we know today. They had to build that settlement because otherwise they would get flooded out, so that means the mole port was likely established very soon after Pluton was put there, and the walls were erected, because otherwise the water would begin accumulating as soon as that happened. They needed to use this port as a means to take building materials, ships.
So you're saying that the walls were erected. So what you're saying is the walls were erected to keep Pluton contained. Yeah. See, I think that's where this is one of the areas where you and the other theory would defer on, because I think in her video, she said that those walls were actually created by Pluton. You know, like when Pluton, because again, like her theory is a little different so far, because her theory, she believes that Pluton came from Enies Lobby, that hole that we seen, that waterfall that we see in Enies Lobby, the big one, right? The one you can't miss at all. It dug through the earth through Enies Lobby from that waterfall. And then it arrived to Wano also erecting those walls. Like when it arrived at Wano, the walls were created. You know what I'm saying? Like that's part of her theory. You know what I'm saying? But it's like, and to me, that would also make sense, because if Wano has some level of geology manipulation, or if Pluton has a degree of geological manipulation, meaning like it could manipulate the terrain of an island or just land in general, right? Then that would make sense of how those walls came to be. You know, it could also make sense how we got the red line in the first place. You know what I mean? Because I personally don't believe the red line is natural. You know, I don't believe that it was always there. I know, you know, I can't really find somewhere where it said that it was like created at one point, but I don't believe it's natural. I think that's part of the reason why Laboon and those other wells are always trying to destroy the red line, because it shouldn't be there. You know, if it was natural, then it should be there. But if it wasn't natural, then it shouldn't be there. And I think that's why those wells try to destroy the red line as well. I believe that's why a lot of the islands in the Grand Line and even the New World have erratic weather patterns, because I believe that's the doing of the red line, because it messes up the weather of the red line and the grand, or it makes it unstable when it comes to the weather in the grand line in the new world.
People, livestock, etc., up to the top, and they would have needed to start that right away because water would have started accumulating on day one. So the people who built the mole port were probably alive when Pluton was placed underground, directly beneath where the port exists. And I bet leadership of Wano at the time knew what Pluton looked like, or at least heard from a credible source like Joy Boy himself, and that may have played a part in the name of the port that would have helped them move up to New Wano. I mean, the people of Old Wano basically woke up one day and had these massive walls placed around their country that blocked them off from the world. So I think it makes a ton of sense to name that port after the creature that is A, directly beneath them, and B, responsible for them building the port and moving up to New Wano in the first place. And the people of Old Wano may not be the only ones who built something with a mole reference, because the Rocket Man is oddly mole-shaped, and it was built by Tom, who also saw the blueprints. And I was actually told I'd get a dislike if I didn't give credit to Keb for this info, so please make sure to drop a like and help me with the algorithm, just in case they go through with it anyway. But I want to make one thing clear about the blueprints. They were for the counter to Pluton, not Pluton itself. Frankie made that clear, and that's why he decided to burn them after knowing Robin wasn't going to use Pluton for evil. However, I am sure the blueprints gave a hint or even a straight-up illustration to what Pluton actually is. It may be a stretch, but the structure of the front of the Rocket Man is similar to that of the moles that we have seen in One Piece. Both Miss Merry Christmas and the Dirt Boss both had long noses just like the Rocket Man. That's and I'm true. Pretty sure that these things are even nostrils, and it even has a face towards the back. Perhaps the Rocket Man and the Sea Train were inspired by Pluton, which was able to do something similar, but by digging underground to enable faster travel for people, similar to the one we saw from the Dirt Boss. And if you're still doubting whether Pluton can even be a living thing because of how often it's been called a battleship...
Hey... I guess we seen eye to eye when it came to Rocket Man, right? Like, I didn't even know you was gonna talk about Rocket Man, but you definitely did.
Keep in mind that San Juan Wolf is literally known as the Colossal Battleship. He was already huge, but now he has a devil fruit that makes him even bigger. So maybe Pluton also has a fruit that.
Now that's where I get confused when it comes to San Juan, right? Because he's so big, right? He's so freaking big, but it's like. How do he... He can't really, like, stand on a ship unless you got, like, a huge ship. But he got a... Like, is he, like, walking through the ocean? Like, how does he get around? Can he shrink? Like, maybe he shrinks. Like, somebody... What y'all think? Maybe San Juan Wolf shrinks and he can get on a ship like normal people. But if he's always that big, right? Like, I would think he couldn't get on a normal ship. Right, like he couldn't fit on a normal ship, meaning he would have to travel through walking through the ocean. But if he has a devil fruit, how's he doing that? You know what I'm saying? How's he doing that? I don't know. I'm curious. It's kind of boggling my mind. Like he has to be able to change sizes, man. He has to.
That enables it to be a ship and a mole at the very same time. And here's something else to think about. The amount of fresh water around Wano has to be extremely heavy. And if Pluton were to move somehow, there would be a huge open crater directly beneath Old Wano and the fresh water. And yes, as we understand it now, the walls may need to be destroyed by Zunisha in order for Pluton to move, but I think Oda could easily subvert our expectations and have Pluton be removed another way. For example, we know Caribou is going to leak Pluton's location to someone that we don't know about just yet, which I think it's Crocodile.
Blackbeard. You say Crocodile, I say Blackbeard. And the reason why I think it's Blackbeard is because I think Blackbeard... of all the characters I believe that will actually successfully collect the ancient weapons and use them are going to be either Luffy or Blackbeard. You know, and even if Blackbeard get it, I think Luffy will eventually get it. You know, so I'm thinking Blackbeard. But if Crocodile get them, if it is Crocodile, maybe he does give it to Luffy, you know. Maybe he does decide to work with Luffy in utilizing them. You know, like, maybe later down the line, Luffy learns that, like, after he goes to Laugh Tale, he learns that he needs the ancient weapons in order to connect the world by destroying the Red Line. And then Crocodile's like, hey, well, you know I got the ancient weapons. You know what I'm saying? Like, maybe it's something along that line. So it could be Crocodile, but I'm kind of thinking Blackbeard. I'm kind of thinking the guy that, what's the name was talking about? What's the name? Caribou was talking about. I think it might be Blackbeard.
But even Caribou himself could just swallow Pluton up with his swamp fruit and take it somewhere else. Blackbeard may also be able to do this. So my point is that there are probably other ways to remove Pluton without destroying the walls. So if Pluton were to be removed somehow, there would be a huge gap under old Wano, and I think there's a good shot that the fresh water simply falls in and sinks old Wano due to the weight. And I also mentioned in my last Pluton video how it would make a lot of sense for Pluton to have dug from Alabasta in the past, where the Pluton Poneglyph was and Crocodile assumed Pluton was, to Wano, where it could then be kept for safekeeping. They could have picked Wano for several reasons, but whatever it was, it seemed Pluton was anchored or caged under Wano. One guess for this is that Pluton is devil fruit related, and we know that sea stone is made in Wano, so perhaps Pluton is at least partially encased in sea stone to keep it from moving, and that's why Wano was required to cage or anchor it. And maybe this could also explain
that. Makes sense. You know, if Pluton is indeed devil fruit related, sea stone would indeed keep it, you know, confined, you know, because if like my thing against the idea of it being like trapped, like imprisoned, at least in Wano, unable to escape, is because if it's just land keeping it in place and you got this device or mole of some sort that can dig through land, you know, it would need something where it couldn't dig out of. Sea stone could make sense, you know.
Explain some of what the blueprints for Pluton's counter told Franky. And if it really did dig to Wano from Alabasta in the past, which is a big if for sure, this part is a little tinfoily, then maybe that water could come crashing down the tunnel and make its way back to Alabasta. I mean, obviously Alabasta is a desert that could use an influx of water, fresh water specifically, and the structure of Alubarna even alludes to the fact that water once covered the island. Shout out once again to my mole deputy for shouting this out. Isn't it odd that Alubarna is situated so much higher than the rest of Alabasta? It's not like they have floods to worry about, or did they? So maybe Alubarna, which was built even before the Void Century, was built up high to be above the water that Alabasta actually had at some point. And so this makes me wonder where all that water went. Well, if Pluton actually left Alabasta as I mentioned, then maybe all that fresh water just fell straight through the tunnel with it, all the way back to Wano. So now when Pluton is freed, perhaps that fresh water is returned all the way to Alabasta so that the people can have a better source of fresh water, be able to grow more crops, develop canals for faster travel, etc. And maybe it seems crazy to think that something so insane could happen with the fresh water, but
that would be tough because if Pluton like traveled through magma when it got to Wano, right, that water probably would have like dissipated. So like, because you know water and magma doesn't necessarily, I mean, it does, but magma will harden, right? Like, the magma would, like, if you got more water than magma, the magma would probably harden and create, like, a barrier, right? But if the water, if it's more magma than water, I would assume the water would probably just, like, evaporate, you know? So, you know, especially traveling so far, right? From one island to another island through the earth, you know, I don't know if it would be, if the water would be able to travel through magma, you know, especially a lot of magma.
But Oda seems to have really focused on the fact that this is fresh water, not seawater. And if the walls just break, then that fresh water is just going to simply fall into the seawater and it's just not going to be able to do anything. So I feel like this is kind of a plot device that Oda has set up that's going to mean a lot more than simply preserving old Wano beneath it. And one last kind of tinfoily idea that I want to throw out there is about the Kozuki Clan crest. And thanks to N for bringing this up. While it obviously looks somewhat like a Jolly Roger, most people have assumed that was just a bird in the middle. But what if this was actually a symbol to hide the three ancient weapons? Much like how the scabbards use different creatures to send hidden messages to people throughout most of Act 1 and 2 in Wano. And of course, Kinemon famously messed up the last one, but that led to confusing Orochi and then Denjiro coming out and explaining it. I mean, the Kozuki clan very clearly has close ties to the Ming, and the Ancient Kingdom, and Joy yeah. Boy himself, so it's not out of the realm of possibility for them to design their crest with the dawn in mind. I mean, the very middle is clearly a duck or a swan head or something, and I think that could be emulating Uranus, which we know is the god of the sky, and many people believe hatched from the egg on Roger's ship. And then okay. Poseidon could be emulated by the fish tails that represent the crossbones, basically representing the various
sea kings. I kind of thought that's where you was going to go with.
And then what about...
Because I was thinking those could be looked at as like whale fins or fish fins. So I was thinking those are definitely connected more to Poseidon, you know. I thought you was going to say that the dove or whatever is in the middle could be a mole, right? That's where I was originally thinking you was going to go with, like the dove being a mole and... being related to Pluton, but yeah, it being a dove, yeah, definitely, because it does have wings. Those definitely do look like wings, so it would probably be more related to Uranus. And then the circle, I'm assuming you're gonna say the circle is gonna be Pluton, and maybe that's like for Earth or, yeah, maybe it's for Earth, I guess, you know. But I'll let you explain it, because I'm thinking Earth, or either that, or it's a hole, right? Because it is like a hole with the dove in the middle. You take the dove out, you just got like a hole, you know? So I'm thinking either Earth or a hole, you know? But either way, I'm thinking the circle is going to be Pluton.
Pluton. Well, that is hidden right here in what looks like the bird wings. Those could just be mole claws. Mm. While it looks like a stylistic choice for the bird wings, I think those could also
easily
be viewed as two mole claws thanks to the long, separate individual claws like moles in One Piece have. And then, of course, we have the sun symbol likely representing how someone will come and lead the ancient weapons to help bring the dawn. Well, that's it for this video, guys. Please like the video, click subscribe, and maybe even check out one of these other two videos that you should probably...
Yeah, man, that was definitely a great theory. Definitely enjoyed it. Probably talked way more than I should have on this one, but, you know, if I talk a lot, that really means, like, it's a good theory, man. Let me like the first one, because I didn't like it when I last left it. I thought I just liked this one. Not... So, yeah, make sure I like both of them. So, yeah. All right, so, yeah, this theory was much different than, or it was a bit different than the other theory that I've seen from Dawn of the World, right? Where hers, I mean, there's some intersections as far as the digging aspect of it, you know, because... I think that's where pretty much both of them kind of overlap when it comes to the theories, is that, you know, that Pluton is something that digs, right? And it came from, Dak believes that it came from Alabasta. Dawn of the World believe it came from Enies Lobby or Water 7, but it dug through Enies Lobby, you know, which caused the hole at Enies Lobby, you know. And I mean, I don't remember if this was stated in the series. I don't know if this was stated, but I think she said that, you know, in her theory, it's believed that, let's say, Pluton was created at Water 7. Like, you know, because we know Water 7 to be a ship-building town, right? A ship-building city. So if it was always a ship-building city, even during the Void Century, maybe... You know, I don't know if this was stated, but I remember she talked about this in the theory. Maybe it was built at Water 7, and when it dug through the earth and arrived at Wano, it went to Enies Lobby's current location, because we know that they're both not that far away from each other, you know. So, yeah, in this theory, though, Dak also believe it could be an actual sentient thing, potentially a mole, you know, or a drill, or some ship of some sort, possibly with a devil fruit, you know. And I don't know exactly what it is. Like I do agree with the aspect of it being something that digs, though. I do agree with that aspect. I like that idea, right? And I like the idea that it can manipulate geology. I didn't really catch Dak say anything about it manipulating geology, but he did say about it causing volcanoes, right? Like it drilling through the earth and then causing volcanoes. So in the way that is geology manipulation, I mean it more in a geology, like an earth bending type sense it for everybody who watch Avatar. Like it could just, you know, maybe send out like, I don't know, like frequencies that causes the geology of an island to change. You know what I'm saying? Or I don't know. I don't know how that would work, but I believe that Pluton manipulates geology to a degree. So that's kind of my belief. And I like this idea that it travels through the earth and it causing volcanoes, which can destroy islands. You know, instead of it being a ship that travels on the earth's surface and destroying islands, I like that it digs through the earth a little more than that. You know, or I like it a lot more than that idea, right? And then it could destroy islands by causing volcanoes and, you know, earthquakes and all types of chaos, right? I like that idea. But yeah, make sure you guys hit that like button. Also subscribe, hit that bell for notifications. Make sure you make sure you leave a comment down below. Do you agree with me? Do you agree with Dak? Or anything? You know, let me know down in the comments. You know, let me know your theory of what Pluton could be, you know, down in the comments. Also follow me on Twitch, so you could catch me live and you can engage with me in real time. Follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. And make sure you become part of the Discord. That's where I'm the most active in. So join the Discord, become a part of the squad, the Blump squad. We share theories. You can also share theories for me to react to, and I'll get to it. I have a submission channel there. But yeah. Also the link to the videos, the two videos that we reacted to, will be in the description box. So y'all make sure y'all show Dak Saki some love. Y'all go like his videos and y'all go subscribe to the man. He makes great content. I reacted to another video of his. It was about One Piece, and I don't want to talk too much about it because I don't want to spoil anything about it. But it is a One Piece it is what the One Piece is and where its location is. So y'all go show Dak some love and go watch that theory. If you haven't watched my reaction to it, go to his channel and watch that theory, because it is a great theory. And yeah, it's your boy Sean P. the Blump God, and I'm out of here. Peace.